Okay, good afternoon and welcome. I'm Candy Welch and I'm pleased to be here today hosting and moderating this webinar for Brain Support Network, a nonprofit focused on education for MSA and Lewy body dementia and brain donation for Parkinson's and all neurological disorders. I'm currently on the BSN board and serve as a leader of our local MSA caregiver support group in the Bay Area. I cared for my husband, Bob, who passed away in 2008. His MSA diagnosis was confirmed following his brain donation. Stanford is pleased to offer the second webinar in our occasional series on Parkinson's and atypical Parkinsonism disorders. We're recording today's event and uploading it to YouTube. So we hope you'll pass it along to others who may be interested. Watch your email after the event for the link. Today's webinar focuses on the troubling symptom of orthostatic hypotension in MSA, Parkinson's, and Lewy body dementia. After our speaker concludes, we will hold a question and answer session. Throughout the presentation, we'll hope that you submit questions using the Q&A button that you'll see at the top of your screen. In addition, we have received many questions in advance of today's webinar. We'll address as many questions as possible in the time allotted. Our guest speaker today is Dr. Veronica Santini. Dr. Santini is a movement disorder specialist at Stanford University. Dr. Santini has special interest in the autonomic system. She takes a holistic approach to patient care and seeks to integrate conservative and alternative therapies where appropriate. And now I'm pleased to turn things over to our guest speaker, Dr. Santini. Welcome.
Hi, Candy. Thank you so much for having me. I'm thrilled and honored to be able to talk about a subject that really affects patients' lives day to day. So let's try and define this orthostatic hypotension. First, to define what's wrong, let's figure out what goes on in the normal state. So what are the normal blood pressure responses to gravitational change? What do I mean by gravitational change? Well, when we go from lying down to standing up or seated to standing up, if we're climbing a steep hill, or even if we're climbing a staircase, there's a change in gravity. And that gravity pulls the blood all into the legs and into the belly. And surprisingly, the blood vessels in the legs and belly can hold up to a liter of blood. Then less blood circulates back to the heart, less blood then leaves the heart, and the blood pressure therefore decreases. Now there are some sensors in the neck, and when less blood goes to the heart, comes out of the heart, and less blood is sensed in the neck, then that sends signals, there's a reflex that sends signals to the blood vessels in the legs and tells them to squeeze. And when the blood vessels tighten and squeeze, the blood pressure can then again increase. And then all the important organs get the nutrients and oxygen they deserve. This is the normal state. In orthostatic hypotension, though, the same thing is happening. The blood goes to the legs or to the belly in response to a gravitational change. Less blood goes to the heart. Less blood leaves the heart, and the blood pressure decreases. But unlike in the normal state, those sensors in the neck are not sending the right reflexes to the blood vessels in the legs. So the blood vessels in the legs don't squeeze. In fact, they stay open in their normal state, and the blood pressure continues to drop. And as the blood pressure continues to drop, less oxygen and nutrients get to those vital organs, and really the most important is the brain, and then patients get symptoms. So let's spend a little bit of time on this busy slide. I wanted to go over the three columns. So the first column is listed as typical symptoms. But what I wanted to say is that columns 2 and 3 are not less common necessarily, but they may be less commonly identified by healthcare providers and by patients and family as being related to the blood pressure. So the symptoms that are typically known to be related to blood pressure are lightheadedness or dizziness. Sometimes people feel like they're about to pass out, you know, that tunnel vision sort of thing, or they actually pass out and lose consciousness. People can feel generally weak or fatigued all day long. They may have visual problems. Visual blurring is quite common. Poor night vision is another problem. And people often describe headaches. Now, less commonly identified symptoms, but again, not less common, just less commonly identified, are leg weakness or leg buckling, walking difficulties, increasing imbalance and falls, particularly upon standing. I mentioned that headaches are common. Well, also neck pain is very common. And then I wanted to spend a little time talking about the confusion that can happen. So patients can get quite confused when they don't have enough oxygen and nutrients getting to their brain. Their thinking may be very slow. So caregivers may say, oh, you know, my husband or wife is just not responding to me. And there can be spacing out episodes that sometimes even look like seizures in the setting of low blood pressure. There can be abnormal movements. So there can be worsening Parkinsonism, worsening tremor, stiffness, slowness. There can be coarse jerking movements. And there can even be worsened cramping and abnormal postures that we call dystonia. Now, a more rare symptom, although can happen, is stroke-like symptoms like focal weakness or numbness in part of the body. So how do we evaluate orthostatic hypotension? Well, we take a history like we do of all symptoms. So we go over the symptoms that I just described and said, you know, are you having any of these? Also, we like to know how much water is the person drinking? How much salt are they eating? That kind of thing. And we'll get back to that. And then we measure in the clinic orthostatic blood pressures. What do I mean by that? Well, we have patients lie down for 3 minutes, and then we take their blood pressure, and then we have them stand. And after 3 minutes, we take their blood pressure again. And we compare the lying down and the standing blood pressures. If there's been a drop of the systolic blood pressure, or the upper number of greater than 20, or of the diastolic blood pressure, the lower number of greater than 10, within those 3 minutes of standing, then we diagnose orthostatic hypotension. We do a neurologic exam, and we take a look for other signs of autonomic system failure. So, are the pupils the same size, or are they very big or small for a person? Do the hands look purpley or mottled? Are there skin changes? Some of these things might be clues to autonomic dysfunction. And finally, when we really want to solidify the diagnosis, we send patients for autonomic testing. Autonomic testing can be done here at Stanford, where we're an autonomic center of the West, in the West. And this testing can be helpful in differentiating Parkinson's disease and Lewy body dementia from multiple system atrophy. So what is the approach to the treatment of orthostatic hypotension? It's really no different than how we approach most things in Parkinson's disease and these other atypical Parkinson's syndromes. So first, we'd like to start with conservative therapy. But if conservative therapies are just not enough or the condition is too severe, then we're going to move on to medications. And when one medicine fails, we're going to need to use combination therapies. So the steps that I follow in the goals of treatment are step number one, prevent the loss of consciousness. I don't want people to lose consciousness if possible. So that's really my first goal. And remember that the treatment of orthostatic hypotension is a process, just like anything else. So it may require multiple visits and multiple steps before achieving some stability of the condition. So step number one is preventing the loss of consciousness. Step number two is preventing close calls. Well, what do I mean by that? Almost losing consciousness. So if people are feeling like they're about to lose consciousness multiple times a day, but they're actually not, that would be the next step to prevent those episodes. Step number three is to then identify what symptoms does each individual person have from low blood pressure. So first, identify those symptoms in your individual patient, or if you're a caregiver in your, or if you're a patient in yourself, if you're a caregiver in the person you're caring for, and prevent the symptoms of the orthostatic hypotension. So one of the most common symptoms that I've mentioned already is leg weakness. So if I'm hearing a lot of leg weakness, falls, somnolence, confusion, I'm definitely going to be taking a look at the orthostatic blood pressures. And finally, step number four, we want to be able to improve fatigue, exercise tolerance, and cognition. So it really is a graduated stepwise process. Now, remember I told you we should start with conservative therapies. Well, sometimes it's not about what we do, but it's about what we don't do. So there are multiple actions we need to avoid. Some of them are physical. So for instance, person with orthostatic hypotension should not be standing motionless. They should be pumping their calf muscles or moving around somewhat in their legs. Standing up too quickly, either from lying down or seated, can cause people to pass out and worsen the blood pressure. Working with the arms above the shoulders is a really big strain for the blood pressure, so that can induce symptoms of orthostatic hypotension. Now, some of the things we can avoid are environmental, so hot environments, or anything that makes us sweat more, hot environments, hot baths, fever can be very stressful in the body, and high altitude. These are all things to avoid with orthostatic hypotension. And if you can't avoid these things, then just to be aware that it could worsen your symptoms temporarily, and perhaps we can increase treatment during that time period. Now, by and large, the most important thing for my patients to avoid is dehydration. Most of my patients are actually dehydrated, and we'll talk about how much water people actually need to be drinking a day. Vigorous exercise can sometimes lower the blood pressure or send it too high. Fast or heavy breathing, large meals, coughing or straining with urination or defecation, all of these things can drop the blood pressure. And then finally, alcohol consumption often can drop the blood pressure since it's toxic to our autonomic nervous system. Now, what can we do on the positive note? Well, we can make sure we're not dehydrated and drink as much fluid as we need every day. Now, many people will be shocked, but most people need at least 60 ounces of water a day. That's approximately a liter and a half. If you look at the left-hand side of the screen, you can see a water bottle that I like. The reason I like this water bottle is I know it holds 20 ounces because on the water bottle, it's got tick marks to show me. This is helpful because I know that we can set a schedule for drinking the water throughout the day to make sure that we've had enough ingested. So I recommend 20 ounces or one of these bottles before noon, 20 ounces before 3 p.m., and then the final 20 ounces at approximately dinner time. Now, if you're somebody who likes to drink water in the morning, get those 20 ounces in the morning, and then maybe by 1 p.m., you'll have your second dose in. In addition to the water, in order to keep the water in your blood vessels and not coming out of your kidneys and into your urine, we advise that people eat salt. Now, some people don't like salt, and so for those people, they get salt tabs to just swallow, salt tablets that are about a gram of salt each tablet, and we say take one of those with every meal. But if you're somebody who likes salt, then today's the day for a field day, because with every meal, we're going to advise that you take some salt in, whether it be chips, pretzels, nuts, eating highly processed foods like deli meats or soups, and then something like tomato juice can often have a gram of salt in it. Also, we advise that people don't lay flat overnight. So we ask you to raise the head of your bed with a wedge pillow or with several pillows stacked up to about 30 degrees. The reason for this is that your body gets used to lying flat. And so if it's been lying flat all night long, then when we get up in the morning, our body is just not used to being upright. So this helps get the body ready to be upright. The other thing it does is it reduces how much urination we have overnight and how much water goes into the kidneys and into the bladder overnight. So we really want people to sleep with their head of the bed slightly elevated. Now, there are also physical maneuvers that can help you raise your blood pressure if you're feeling a little bit lightheaded. So, for instance, if you look over to the right, Lowe and colleagues came up with this paper in 2008 that describes some of the physical maneuvers that they showed can increase the blood pressure. And so in A and B on the slide on the right, you can see that people are giving themselves kind of calf pumps and squeezing their calves. Remember, the more the blood vessels in the calf in the calf squeeze, the more your blood pressure will raise. So the muscles in the calf help to squeeze those blood vessels. I like picture D, for instance, because if you're talking to somebody and you feel, hey, I feel a little lightheaded, it might be time to put your foot up on a stair and pump your calf muscles. And this can prevent you from passing out. And finally, remember we talked about hot environments being a problem in orthostatic hypotension. Well, we advise things like cooling vests and cooling scarves to reduce how much you're sweating. And then to help squeeze those blood vessels even more, the blood vessels in the legs and in the abdomen, we advise that patients try leg sleeves. Now, many people have tried compression stockings, and they work in the same way, but boy, are they hard to get on. So I advise my patients purchase leg sleeves that don't have the foot portion, and they're just a little bit easier to get on. This can also help with, this can often help with the symptoms of orthostatic hypotension. Likewise, people can wear tight binders around their abdomen after they eat so that all the blood doesn't rush to their gut while they're digesting. Moving on to FDA-approved medications for orthostatic hypotension. The first of these, the oldest medication we have, is something called fludrocortisone, or Flurinef. This medicine expands the blood volume, so it helps to increase how much water and salt stay in the blood, and therefore expanding the blood volume and the blood pressure. The doses that have been studied are 0.1 to 0.5 milligrams per day. However, I typically use only up to 0.2 milligrams per day because above that, I don't find a lot more benefit, but I do find that patients complain about more side effects. Now, this medicine needs to be used carefully because for patients who have congestive heart failure or who have kidney problems, they may actually retain too much fluid, and then they can have problems with swelling or problems with breathing normally. Also, patients can get electrolyte abnormalities. So I know when prescribing this medication, I need to alert the primary care physician that I'm doing so. And we both need to be checking electrolytes fairly frequently, checking the sodium, checking the potassium, and others. Finally, there are some fairly common side effects with this medication, including headache, swelling, weight gain, and this medicine, because it boosts blood pressure, it can sometimes cause high blood pressure if somebody is lying down flat. Moving on to midodrine or proamitine. So midodrine is a medication that actually helps to squeeze those blood vessels in the legs and in the arms. And by doing so, it increases blood pressure. The doses of this medication are between 5 and 10 milligrams 3 times daily, but I certainly have used even higher doses of up to 20 milligrams 3 times daily in severe cases. It has some common but unusual side effects, so it's important to be aware of these so that you know it's coming from the medication. These side effects that I'm about to mention are not harmful, but they may be bothersome. And so it's important to know it would be coming from the medication. So for instance, people can get dilated pupils, and that sometimes can cause blurry vision. People can get goose pimples or goose flesh, as they do when they have chills. And it's an unusual reaction. And so people usually say, well, what is this coming from? Sometimes people get tingling, and other times people complain of itching. This medication can also cause high blood pressure when people are lying down flat. So again, a concern with both of these medicines. Finally, the most recently FDA-approved medication, and by far the medicine I get asked about the most in orthostatic hypotension, is something called droxidopa, or Northera is the trade name. Droxidopa is actually a precursor to norepinephrine. Norepinephrine is an amphetamine-like substance that is produced by our body, and it has several mechanisms of action, and we're not sure which one it is that boosts the blood pressure, but it certainly has been shown to boost blood pressure. Interestingly, if you don't have any problems, if you're just a normal, healthy individual, norepinephrine increases when you stand up. And we think that this helps to increase the blood pressure in response to a gravitational change. In Parkinson's disease, Lewy body dementia, and in multiple system atrophy, we know that norepinephrine levels are low when people are standing. So we think that it's helpful in these conditions because it helps to boost the norepinephrine levels. The dosage range is quite wide, and people can start at 100 milligrams three times a day and go all the way up to 600 milligrams three times a day. Common side effects of this medication include headaches. It can be up to 13% in clinical trials, dizziness, nausea, blurry vision, and again, high blood pressures. This medicine can again cause high blood pressure when lying flat. If we know patients are on these medications during the day, we advise people to generally not lie down flat throughout the day so as not to cause high blood pressure. In addition, we have to be careful that we don't dose these medications too late in the afternoon so that when people go to sleep at night, they're not suffering from high blood pressure. Now, let's just discuss a couple of non-FDA-approved pharmacotherapies. So, a medication that I use quite commonly in my practice to treat orthostatic hypotension is pyridostigmine or mestinon. Now, pyridostigmine actually improves the standing blood pressure, so it boosts the standing blood pressure, but it does not increase blood pressures when people are lying down flat. So for those people who have high blood pressure when lying down flat, I can use this medication safely. It can be used and is effective alone, but it can also be used in combination, and this has been studied with midodrine specifically. But I personally have used it in combination with fludrocortisone, midodrine, and Northera. The side effects for this medication include diarrhea. Now, in my Parkinson's patients who typically suffer from constipation, they don't typically get diarrhea from this medicine, but they get normal stool. So actually, a lot of people really like that side effect. Excessive salivation that we know can happen in Parkinsonian conditions anyway can get worse with mestinon, and that is the same for muscle cramps and twitching as well. People can also complain of nausea and vomiting with this medication. And finally, an over-the-counter supplement that I wanted to talk about was Yohimbine. So Yohimbine is a supplement that that we know can also increase norepinephrine levels and also increase the blood pressure. But it has some dangerous side effects that we need to know about. So it can cause confusion and disorientation. It can cause increases in the heart rate, headache, and worsening tremor. Also, Yohimbine has a lot of medication interactions, so it's very important you're discussing the use of Yohimbine with your provider and you let them know because it may interfere with other prescribed medications. Finally, we know that over-the-counter supplements like Yohimbine or quote-unquote natural or herbal supplements are not regulated in the same way by the FDA as prescribed medications. So we do have to be careful about safety in these medications, and I just encourage you to discuss with your physician all the supplements and medications you're taking. So I wanted to thank you so much for your time today. In the top row here, you can see our brand new Neurosciences Health Center that is a state-of-the-art facility, and we've got all kinds of free neuroscience supportive care programs free to our patients within the building, as well as physical therapy and all kinds of other therapies and MRI scans and everything. In addition, the second row is our movement disorder providers. So you're always welcome to send a referral in, and we'd be happy to see you. So I think I'll pass it back to Candy.
Okay. Well, thank you so much, Dr. Santini. That was a wonderful presentation. But before we actually move on to our Q&A segment, we'd like to ask everybody to, we want to make sure we capture your survey responses. And in order to do that, we need you to click on in the Q&A box at the top of your screen, and we'll open a link to our survey. The only reason we mention it now is it has to be opened up before the presentation ends, or we won't be able to capture your feedback. So please just open it up. You can complete it after we're done, but it has to be opened up during the presentation. Okay, so we can move on here to our questions. And these are some of the ones that we received before we did the webinar. First one we've got here is, what can caregivers do to help?
Yeah, so caregivers, as you know, Candy, are really vital for the care of our patients. And, unfortunately, the burden really does sometimes fall on the caregiver to be that nagging reminder, hey, make sure you're drinking the water that you need to drink. Make sure we're making salty meals for you and you're eating all the salt that you can. And sometimes that means the caregiver and the patient eating two different meals. Also, checking blood pressure. So helping the patient to monitor the blood pressure and doing those orthostatic blood pressures at home. The other thing that caregivers are so helpful for is oftentimes they're my eyes and ears. So I have a lot of wonderful patients that really don't complain of many symptoms because they've gotten used to the way it feels to have such low blood pressure. But when I ask the caregiver, they're able to tell me, hey, my loved one is falling more, doesn't seem to be as with it. They seem more confused. They're really tired. They're falling asleep all the time. Those, in that way, the caregivers are really my eyes and ears, and I can identify those symptoms as being part of the blood pressure issue and then be more aggressive about treating it.
Yeah, caregivers definitely end up being, you move into definitely that parent role. I mean, you're overseeing all the patient's care, and you're so right. That's the eyes and ears for the care team, for sure.
Yeah, and that brings up such an important part that the caregivers have to have the right amount of support as well. So please don't be a martyr if you're a caregiver. Let's get some people to come into the home and help with what they can help with. Sometimes we can get somebody to come into the home to record blood pressures, that kind of thing. So let's get the help that we can get in the home as well.
Right. That's great advice. Okay. Our second question here is, how do you keep someone safe with OH without confining them to a wheelchair all the time?
And this is a great question, because I really, as a physician, don't like when a patient comes to me and they tell me they've basically been wheelchair bound because of the blood pressure issues. I think as providers, we have to make sure we're not becoming complacent with just good enough blood pressures. We have mm-hmm. to make sure the blood pressures are enough that people have good qualities of life. So it's a stepwise process. Hang in there. But if we follow the steps 1 through 4, as I outlined before, first preventing passing out, then preventing almost passing out, then addressing and identifying the symptoms, and then addressing the fatigue and all the other parts to it. I think if we really take that stepwise approach, nobody should be suffering and be confined to a wheelchair. And I don't know if you have any additional thoughts, Candy, about
that. Well, I think I mentioned to you before how helpful we had a reclining wheelchair for my husband,
yes.
The tilt wheelchair. And I know they're expensive, but our insurance did cover it. So that was the good news. But that was just the greatest thing to have, because he could be sitting up or standing up, and then if he needed to sit down really quickly, sit him down and tilt him back, and he'd feel better immediately. So that was actually it's a great thing to have. So
that can be very helpful. And oftentimes, if patients or families bring this up to the provider, including myself, we're able to write a letter on your behalf to get such a device, and get it covered.
Oh, that's great. Yeah. Okay, so here's our next one. How does blood pressure affect brain function?
Oh gosh, boy, does it affect brain function. Mm-hmm. And the way that we think it's affecting brain function, although there's several different philosophies and I don't know that we have a proven reason just yet, is we think just the blood the blood carrying all the oxygen and nutrients just doesn't get to certain brain parts. So for instance, the most upper parts of the brain, really the part that is farthest away from gravity, where the blood pressure has to do the most work to bring the oxygen and nutrients, those are the parts of the brain that affect thinking, and those are the parts of the brain that affect leg function. And so if we are talking about symptoms of orthostatic hypotension, it's all due most likely to the fact that we're not getting the nutrients and oxygen to those brain parts that we need to. So it's all of those symptoms that we mentioned, visual blurring, headaches, neck pain, because we're not getting the nutrients to the neck that we need to, dizziness, etc.
Okay. Our next question is here. Are there any new blood pressure treatments?
So the newest blood pressure treatment is the one that I mentioned, Northera or droxidopa. And this medication is the most recently FDA approved medicine. And I have to say my anecdotal evidence is that it's quite effective. The issue is the new blood pressure medicines, remember, are always more expensive. So sometimes the best therapy for patients is not the newest thing that's out, but it could be the tried and true medication that we have 20 years of experience with. So in order to prevent my patients who are already taking lots and lots of medicines, prevent them from paying too much, I sometimes do start with those tried and true therapies. And it's not because I don't know what the new therapy is, but it's because I know that those old therapies are very effective and won't put my patients in the poorhouse.
Okay. How do blood pressure medications interact with Parkinson's medications?
Oh, what a wonderful, wonderful question, and something we really haven't had time to address today. So we have several issues here. Parkinson's disease and atypical Parkinsonian syndromes like Lewy body dementia and MSA cause problems with orthostatic hypotension. So the disease itself causes problems with orthostatic hypotension. But guess what, Candy? Almost every single medicine that we give to treat Parkinsonian symptoms, they also drop the blood pressure, unfortunately.
Right. It's the old table leg situation. That's what we used to always call it,
Yeah, it's just awful. So we want to get people's symptoms better, but we can't increase the Parkinsonian medicines because it's dropping the blood pressure too much. So what I want patients to understand is don't suffer. Let your doctor boost the blood pressure with certain medicines and then get you on the appropriate therapy for Parkinson's disease. Is it more medicines? Yeah. And that kind of stinks. I get it. But if it improves your quality of life, both because you can move better and because you can think and aren't dizzy and don't have all those extra symptoms, hey, it's worth it, I think. I see time and time again that people are not put on the appropriate doses of carbidopa, levodopa, for instance, because their blood pressure can't handle it. To me, that's kind of unacceptable. I would boost the blood pressure and then add the carbidopa, levodopa.
Okay, great. Yeah, that's great advice too. Can beta blockers help?
Okay, so beta blockers, you have to be careful. So beta blockers are often used for tremor control, and we use ones that don't affect the blood pressure too much. Beta blockers can be helpful for people who have very elevated heart rates. But usually, I think the best treatment is to sort of to use the blood pressure boosting agents. Usually what I find, or oftentimes what I find in the absence of Northera, which can cause sometimes some increased heart rate, usually what I find is if you treat the blood pressure and you optimize it, that heart rate can come down as well.
Okay. All right, go to our next page here. What food and supplements are best for OH? Should anything be avoided?
Oh, yes. I love this question. What great questions. Oh, my gosh. Such informed patients and providers and caregivers. So what foods and supplements are best for OH? Well, I'll tell you, it's not so much which foods, but probably how often you're eating and how much you're eating. What I advise is that people eat multiple small meals during the day rather than three large meals. The bigger the meal, the more your blood pressure can drop after meals. Now, if you're somebody who's susceptible to blood pressure drops after meals, then one thing that can be very helpful is to put an abdominal binder on. Put it on about 10 minutes before you eat. Have it on tightly while you're eating, and then keep it on for about an hour after eating. This can help to avoid the orthostatic hypotension that happens with food intake.
Okay.
As far as what foods are best, we know that people can have difficulty with digestion of gluten or with digestion of lactose. So sometimes I tell my patients, hey, why don't you take 2 weeks and go gluten-free and see if it helps you to digest a little bit better? Or hey, if that didn't make a difference, go ahead and reintroduce the gluten and why don't you try going lactose-free? And some people think it makes a difference and other people say, hey, it didn't do anything. So I think it's a good experiment.
Okay. Yeah, that's great because, you know, it really doesn't matter sometimes whether, you know, things help if there's like a medical reason for it. You know,
right.
Sometimes, I mean, I found that definitely with my husband that, you know, we just experiment with little things like that. And sometimes we got really lucky. So
right.
We could find things that really made him feel better.
Right. Okay. And little changes. So
exactly. Exactly.
Yeah.
What do you do if you have both OH and hypertension?
Oh, this is by far the most challenging of the group. So, you know, here's where you have to decide on goals of care. Most commonly, people have that hypertension or that high blood pressure when they're laying flat or when they're lying down flat. So the issue there is avoiding that flat positioning during the day. And at night, what we sometimes do is we give a short-acting high blood pressure medicine. So I'll give something like captopril, which is short-acting, but there's others like clonidine or others that might be short-acting that you can use overnight. What becomes more challenging is when people have these wide swings in blood pressure. You know, this is extremely common in MSA and also common in advanced Parkinson's disease. So my patients will bring their blood pressure log, and even sometimes standing, they'll have very high blood pressures, or sitting, they'll have very high blood pressures, you know, 180s, 190s systolic, and then extremely low blood pressure standing in the 60s, 70s, 80s. And of course, people are passing out when that happens. So sometimes we have to do lots of things. So one thing that we do in those circumstances is we'll ask patients to take their blood pressure before they take the blood pressure boosting medicine. So if their blood pressure is above 180, let's say, we may say, don't take the blood pressure boosting medicine. And you can recheck the blood pressure a little bit later in the day. Sometimes it means that we just have to avoid anything that's causing the high blood pressure. And then sometimes we have to live with the fact that sometimes people have high blood pressure and we know it, and otherwise we're going to try and boost the blood pressure because that's what's causing them more symptoms.
Right.
So even though we don't love that, sometimes we do have to make that compromise.
Okay. Can salt tablets help? I think you did address that, but if you want to speak more to that.
Yeah. So if people can't eat the amount of salt that they should, you know, I'm somebody who hates salt. So if I had this problem, I know my doctor would be giving me salt tablets. So it's basically how much you can ingest versus if you don't like salt, we'll give you a gram of salt with every meal in a tablet form.
Okay. Can OH cause shortness of breath?
Oh, yes, absolutely. It's a pretty common symptom. And the reason for that symptom is that the upper lung fields aren't seeing as much blood as they usually do when you're standing up. So gravity's pulling all the blood down, and those very upper lung fields feel like they're not breathing. So people feel short of breath.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Why does the blood pressure drop with exercise?
Yeah, it's interesting. So sometimes it can drop with exercise and sometimes it can increase with exercise. Now, has anybody, this will be a rhetorical question, but I'm sure people have seen maybe basketball games or even football games on the television. And you can see that all those athletes are wearing all these sleeves, these white sleeves on their arms and their legs. Guess what those are? Those are compression sleeves. Because when we exercise, the blood vessels open up really wide. so that all the blood flow can get to those muscles that are working so hard. But the problem is in orthostatic hypotension, we don't have those extra reflexes to boost the blood pressure back up. So sometimes vigorous exercise can definitely drop the blood pressure in orthostatic hypotension. So those leg sleeves and those arm sleeves can be very helpful.
Okay. Can OH lead to sudden death?
So it's not typically, so it's a more rare circumstance. It certainly can lead to heart dysfunction, and that could lead to sudden death. We know that in autonomic dysfunction, people can also have arrhythmias, and that can lead to sudden death. So if not exactly orthostatic hypotension, sometimes it's the autonomic failure that involves the heart that can lead to sudden death.
Okay. Is OH more severe in MSA than in PD or LBD?
Yes. Okay.
And there's a second part to this. Is treatment of OH different with these three diseases?
So the treatment algorithm tends to be very similar, but you have to be ready as the caregiver and the patient and the healthcare provider to accept more in MSA. So MSA is more severe. Orthostatic hypotension is typically more severe in MSA than in Parkinson's or Lewy body dementia. Sometimes very advanced Parkinson's and Lewy body dementia. And what I mean by advanced is not necessarily how, you know, what stage of disease you're in, but maybe how long you've had the disease. So some patients with the disease 10 or more years may have kind of severe swings in their blood pressure, just like you see in MSA. But what makes MSA more severe is that these symptoms come on dramatically very early in the disease course. So it's one of the most prominent symptoms people have throughout the entire disease course. Mm-hmm. The treatment is not so different, but the treatment goals may be different for MSA versus Parkinson's disease or Lewy body dementia. So we may be more aggressive in treating those low blood pressures in MSA and allowing some of those really high blood pressures we normally don't like, for instance.
Okay. All right. Next. Oh, sorry. Oh, we have more questions that people have just dialed in here. So first one here is, someone has MSA with OH, but also supine hypotension. Have you ever heard of this problem?
Yeah, that's interesting. So say that one more time. They have orthostatic hypotension.
Right, but also supine hypotension. So they've got, yeah.
Yeah, so they have it both, huh?
Right.
Never can get that blood pressure up. Well, the good news is that is the easiest scenario to treat. All we have to do there is be quite aggressive with the blood pressure management, both in the lying down and the standing position. So actually, this one's a very easy one to treat. Now, in this circumstance, I would be concerned that maybe something else could also be going on. So this would be a circumstance that I may advise that the patient get autonomic testing, for instance, here at Stanford, because we may find that, hey, their diabetes is part of this, or hey, they have some sort of paradoxical reaction that we can kind of go after. You know, so I think that might be a circumstance that would be worth autonomic testing to make sure we're not missing something else that's contributing to the orthostatic hypotension.
Okay. Someone has primary autonomic failure with possible MSA. Does OH occur in PAF or autonomic failure? Okay.
Oh yeah, absolutely. So this whole category of PAF or primary autonomic failure is a super difficult one. And actually there's a large study that Stanford is currently involved in with other institutions across the country looking at what the natural history of this primary autonomic failure disease is. It turns out that some of these folks actually turn into MSA or Parkinson's disease. So there's a group of these patients that actually do convert into meeting diagnostic criteria for these Parkinsonian symptoms. But some people just have the autonomic failure. They don't have the Parkinsonism as much, and they don't have progressive Parkinsonism. But the main symptom that a lot of these patients have is orthostatic hypotension, and they really, really suffer from that.
Okay, yeah, because I know that Bob was first diagnosed with primary autonomic failure, and then, you know, as the disease progressed, then they changed the diagnosis. So
yes, I
know that can happen. Yeah.
Yeah.
So the next one is, Northera doesn't seem to help. Should I stop and restart it?
No. So it depends on the dosage. So what I always advise is when something doesn't seem like it's helping, it's time to give that feedback to the doctor. And most of the time, we don't even need to see you in the clinic. Sometimes we do because we can't quite get the right history over the phone, or it's just a little bit too complicated for us to sort through over the phone. But oftentimes, it just is a matter of changing the dose. So if you're at max doses of the Northera, let's say 600 milligrams three times a day, and it still doesn't seem to be working, that's when maybe we should re-examine everything else. I'm a physician that really feels that everybody needs to be doing kind of all of the different parts in order for this disease to really be under good control. So if the Northera is not helping enough, are we drinking as much water as we should be? Are we eating as much salt? Are we wearing the compression stockings? Have you tolerated fludrocortisone? If you haven't, should we retry it and see if you can tolerate it now? Are you on appropriate doses of fludrocortisone or midodrine? Would adding pyridostigmine help the situation? So these are all things that I would advise, kind of a reassessment of all the therapies for the blood pressure. When things are really rough, we may need to very temporarily reduce the anti-Parkinsonian medicine. So reducing that carbidopa levodopa or reducing the dopamine agonist. One final thing is that sometimes we don't need to reduce the Sinemet or the carbidopa levodopa. But what we need to do is we need to increase the amount of carbidopa the patient is getting. And that's really a whole nother discussion, but it can reduce the side effects of levodopa sometimes. So that might be another thing to look at.
Okay.
I hope I'm making sense and not being
too confusing. Definitely. Yeah, that's a great answer. So have you heard of coconut oil helping OH?
Well, coconut oil is the new magic food supplement. So it seems to me that every few years, there's a magic one that comes out. I know I had a health issue and coconut oil, very separate from Parkinson's disease, and coconut oil was advised to cure all of my issues as well. So I don't think that we have great data to suggest it. That being said, coconut oil is a great thing to cook in. It's a very, very helpful fat additive. And so do I think it's harmful? Probably not. If you're somebody who has high cholesterol, you might want to be talking to your primary care about whether it's safe for you to have this oil or not. But I don't think we have great evidence to suggest that it helps, unfortunately.
Okay.
I just think it's become the new magic for everything.
Right, right. I know. Even brushing your teeth.
Oh, yeah,
definitely. You know, that whole thing. Yeah, okay. Someone says here he feels faint when he's defecating. Do you have any tips for that?
Yeah, so let's work on the constipation regimen at that point, because what happens when we defecate, whenever we're straining, either to urinate or to defecate, it activates the opposite side of our autonomic nervous system. It says, oh, let's drop the blood pressure and relax. And that's obviously not what we want to do. So sometimes people actually pass out when they're on the toilet. Mm-hmm. And of course, that's embarrassing and certainly not good for quality of life.
And dangerous.
And extremely dangerous. Yeah. The bathrooms are so dangerous.
Mm-hmm.
So what I would advise is that really you're treating constipation so that there's no straining, okay? And we don't want people to have diarrhea, because you can strain with diarrhea as well. So using Miralax if necessary, stool softeners, Senna, Colace, all of these great medications. One of my favorite things to tell patients to use is to use something called a squatty potty, where you just bring your knees up on a stool in front of your toilet. So your knees are higher, and it kind of simulates how it would be if you were using the restroom in the woods, mm-hmm. so to speak. And
yeah.
It can sometimes help you evacuate a little bit easier without having to strain.
And I've also actually seen those for sale at Costco.
Yes, they sure do. You're right. And then the other thing is sometimes massaging the belly as you're sitting there rather than straining. So mm-hmm. massaging the backside and kind of massaging the front lower belly can sometimes help to move things along. I recommend that everybody tries to go to the bathroom around the same time every day and after eating a hot meal, because it helps. There's a reflex that helps you evacuate your bowels after you've eaten a hot meal. So okay. Those are my constipation tips.
Okay. Can any antidepressants help OH?
Oh, that's such a great question, because I did take it out of the last slide. One of the things that has been studied is Prozac and a number of other SSRI medications or antidepressant medicines. So if your doctor is prescribing you this for orthostatic hypotension, they're not tricking you. It's actually for the orthostatic hypotension, and they're not just trying to treat some underlying depression. There's been small studies to show that perhaps it can help boost the blood pressure.
Okay, that's interesting. I never heard of that. Yeah. Is Parkinson's with OH more severe or more rapidly progressing?
You know, I don't like when people say that. I think that everybody who has Parkinson's disease has a different form of disease. So I have heard the strangest symptoms that are what we would consider off medication symptoms. Symptoms that we don't normally attribute to Parkinson's disease, but happen to be attributed for that person. So what I would say is the person who gets orthostatic hypotension, and by the way, it's many people with this disease, very, very common, those people just tend to be, it's a little bit unlucky, because with orthostatic hypotension, you get a lot of symptoms. And although you feel horrible and you may even feel like you're dying sometimes, it doesn't mean that your Parkinson's is more severe just because you have those symptoms. Okay. It means that it's something that we need to treat and get your quality of life better.
Okay. It seems that OH research is focused on MSA. Do you feel that's true? And if so, why?
Yes, that's very true. And the reason for it is that MSA is a population that has it early and severe in their disease course. So if you, so it's very helpful for recruiting of trials. And also, because this is the most severe form of autonomic failure, we feel that if things are working in MSA, it might be, it probably will work in Parkinson's disease.
Okay.
Now, is that right? No, I think that more studies should be done in Parkinson's disease. Where I trained at Boston University, we at Braintree Rehabilitation Center, several studies did come out of the there, and we were able to show that improvements in blood pressure really improved cognition and motor function. And also studies coming out of that work showed that approximately 30% of newly diagnosed Parkinson's patients may have orthostatic hypotension. So I do agree that I think it's an understudied phenomenon in Parkinson's disease. But the reason for it is that it's so severe in MSA that that's the patient population that most people have studied.
Okay. If I have severe OH, what kind of doctor should I see?
Yeah, it can depend. So it depends on the specialty at different centers. So for instance, if you come and see a movement disorder provider like me and many of the people in my group, I in particular had additional training in this, so I feel very, very comfortable managing this. But some movement disorder specialists would prefer that you see an autonomic specialist.
Okay.
And so we certainly have those specialists here at Stanford. Other people who can treat orthostatic hypotension may include cardiologists, or kidney doctors, nephrologists. So there's a wide range of practitioners that treat it, and we just have to figure out in which center the people who feel most comfortable are.
Okay. Is OH caused by a pathology in the brain?
It's hard to say, but we know that people who have alpha-synucleinopathies, and those are the three conditions that we've been talking about today, Parkinson's disease, Lewy body dementia, and multiple system atrophy. We know that these people with these pathology, and what I mean by that is the buildup of an abnormal protein called alpha-synuclein in certain brain cells. We know that people with these conditions have that abnormal protein buildup, and those people can be affected by orthostatic hypotension. Interestingly, other atypical Parkinsonian symptoms, syndromes like PSP or CBS, other atypical syndromes that don't have alpha-synuclein, they typically do not have orthostatic hypotension either. So in these conditions, we believe it to be somehow related to the dysfunction that is caused by this abnormal protein, alpha-synuclein.
Okay. Does Stanford have an autonomic testing center? Do you know where other centers are, and what's the value of being seen at one of these centers?
Yes, so Stanford does have a very good autonomic testing center. And again, if things are slightly unusual, if the patient has multiple diseases that could be at play, like diabetes and Parkinson's disease, for instance, or if things seem more severe than we would normally expect for Parkinson's disease, and we're curious if this is MSA versus Parkinson's disease, those are all indications to get more extensive testing. The centers that do this type of testing, in the West, I would say that Stanford is one of the most prominent, and I'm not sure if it's the only center, but it's one of the most prominent out here. On the East Coast, there are other centers like Beth Israel has a great autonomics program, and Mayo Clinic in the middle of the country has an autonomics program as well. But if people are interested, we are happy to do a comprehensive evaluation here at Stanford.
Okay. Some research shows that MD-COH and diagnose MSA. In fact, many have Parkinson's. What's happening here?
Oh, yeah, I agree with that. In fact, as a movement disorder specialist, I see plenty of people who are newly diagnosed who might have some degree of orthostatic hypotension. And most often what I see is that patients have been misdiagnosed with MSA because they have normal Parkinsonian symptoms, but they get put on dopaminergic medications that lower their blood pressure. And then the doctor says, oh no, maybe they actually have MSA and I missed that, forgetting that the medicines we use also lower the blood pressure. So I see this kind of thing quite commonly. And what I would recommend is that when there is a question, people probably should get autonomic testing, which can be helpful to differentiate the two conditions. And also to be seen by a movement disorder specialist. So this question between typical Parkinson's disease and atypical syndromes comes up a lot. And I think you really need a subspecialist who sees a lot of these syndromes to be able to differentiate. There are set criteria in the literature that helps you to differentiate these conditions. And oftentimes for me, even if I'm seeing someone 5 years down the line, the history of their initial symptoms is what can really help me figure out their diagnosis. Also, seeing how they progress can be helpful for me to figure out the diagnosis.
Okay. And I just have one question. What is the evaluation like at these testing centers and what makes it different?
Yeah, so autonomic testing is very specific. So basically, we have people laying flat on a special bed, and we do all kinds of things. We infuse a chemical into their, very superficially into their skin to see how much they sweat on their limbs. Do they sweat the appropriate amount or do they sweat less? We have them do deep breathing exercises and see if their heart rate and their blood pressure responds appropriately. And we do the thing that all patients really don't like, is we take them from a position where they're lying flat and jerk their body upright on a table that's secure and that they're strapped into so that they won't fall. And we look at the various responses of the heart rate and the blood pressure. Depending on all the different responses of all these different tests, we're able to see, hey, are these normal responses or are these abnormal? And if they're abnormal, are they coming from the brain or are they coming from the peripheral nervous system? So that can be helpful to differentiate.
Okay. And our last question here, what about methotrexate?
Methotrexate.
Thank you.
Yeah, no problem. So methotrexate, it really depends on, so I guess a little more context for this question would be helpful. Methotrexate can be used if there is a thought that perhaps there's some sort of immune component to why people have autonomic dysfunction. So it's not a typical medication that's used to boost blood pressure, or it's not typically used in Parkinson's disease or the conditions that we've talked about today. So that's really usually due to another reason for autonomic dysfunction.
Okay. Well, I think this is going to wrap this up. We do want to thank you and all of our attendees for joining, and I do hope that your time here has been well spent. You see on the slide, our last slide here is on your screen, is about further information, and this will be emailed to you when the link comes through for the webinar.